I'm a little self-conscious about the fact that hardly anybody wants to sit on the side that me and Kim and it's something about us six, I don't know.
I don't know.
But, all right. Let's go ahead and begin our worship service by singing hymn number 193, It Came Upon a Midnight Clear. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, for the fact that for salvation, Lord, that you sent your Son, Jesus Christ. He's born a man, lived a righteous life, and died a painful death, a death he didn't deserve, to pay the penalty for our sins so that we could have salvation through Christ and have eternity with you in heaven. And we thank you, Lord, for this as we celebrate Christmas. At the end of service, we'll do the Lord's Supper and look at Christ's death and put the whole thing together. And it's just an amazing thing that you've done, Lord, and we thank you for it. Now we ask for your blessing on our service, and that through all we do here, you would be praised and honored and glorified. Thank you, Lord. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, let me go over a couple announcements. We will not be having afternoon service today since it's Christmas Eve day. I'm sure there's a lot of family things going on, so no afternoon service. We will have junior church, though, today. Let's see, we will be having Wednesday service this week. It says here that we're going through 1 Timothy, but we've actually suspended that for a couple weeks and been doing Christmas theme stuff, and we will again do that again this week. But if you haven't joined us before and you'd like to, it's at 6 p.m. on Wednesday evening. We'll do a little lesson and then have some prayer time. The next ladies' book study is going to be on January 6th, chapter 6. Angie's going to be leading it. And then on the 14th, after the morning service, we'll have our lunchtime like we usually have, and then we'll have our annual business meeting where we will review the year in the past and where we stand, and we also have some things to bring to the church and perhaps some things to vote on. Not quite 100% sure on that, but if you're a member, please try and make that. Even if you're not a member, you're invited to stay, and just can't vote if we do vote on some. All right. Let's have this next scripture reading, Carol.
David wrote in Psalm 103, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from destruction, who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies your mouth with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord executes righteousness and justice for all who are oppressed. He made known his way to Moses, his acts to the children of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in mercy. He will not always strive with us, nor will he keep his anger forever. He has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor punished us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. As a father pities his children, so the Lord pities those who fear him. For he knows our frame. He remembers that we are dust. As for man, his days are like grass. As a flower of the field, so he flourishes. For the wind passes over it, and it is gone, and its place remembers it no more. But the mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting on those who fear him, and his righteousness to children's children, to such as keep his covenant, and to those who remember his commandments to do them. The Lord has established his throne in heaven, and his kingdom rules over all. Bless the Lord, you his angels, who excel in strength, who do his word, heeding the voice of his word. Bless the Lord, all you his hosts, you ministers of his, who do his pleasure. Bless the Lord, all his works, in all places of his dominion. Bless the Lord, O my soul." And today, as we celebrate the birth of Christ as well as his death, we should bless the Lord.
Okay, let's sing another Christmas hymn, number 180, "What Child Is This?"
Thank you.
On December 9th, 1965, a program came out that critics said would never last. Well, it did. It has lasted to this day. And Bob is going to play, I think, the most important portion of that program.
We can watch it again. Way to go, Linus and Charles Schultz.
All right.
Let's sing one more song before the message. This is Carl's personal favorite. We'll do 183, O Holy Night.
Thank you.
Many of you will notice that the words that we have in our hymnal are rather different from the ones you normally hear at Christmas time. If you take a good look just under the title of the hymn, you will see that it was originally done by a John S. Dwight and revised by an Avis B. Christensen. Avis Christensen was born in 1895 and died in 1985. She was born into a Christian home and actually attended Moody Bible. And over the course of her lifetime, either wrote or revised or worked with literally hundreds of hymns. It's always been my favorite Christmas hymn, but the first time that we sang it here and I saw these different words, I'm going, wow, this is fantastic. Far more biblical yet than what was originally written. Think of it, you know, and just in the second verse, sent from on high to purchase our salvation, that we might dwell with him ever above. What an incredible thought that is. At this time of the year, we come to a little town by the name of Bethlehem. Not very big, a few miles from Jerusalem. But something very special happened on that night. Young couple, Mary and Joseph, with Mary being pregnant, had come to Bethlehem because there was a census going on. And people were required to go to their hometowns to register for that census. So, Mary, Joseph, headed out, coming from Nazareth. Journey of somewhere in the vicinity of 90 miles, and that's if they basically went straight through. One of the things to think about is that part of their journey would have been through Samaria. And if you know how the Jews felt about Samaritans, there were many Jews who would not go through Samaria. In which case the journey, if that was how they felt, they would have had to go around one way or the other. So the journey probably would have been over that, if in fact they didn't go through Samaria. We don't know. The other potential problem along the way is, who are they traveling with? Because if you didn't travel in a large group, you faced the possibility of bandits along the way. It's not uncommon in those days, and especially in the out-of-the-way places, that lone travelers could be held up. So Mary and Joseph may very well have gone with a number of other people, and depending on the stops along the way, the group may have gotten smaller and smaller. The other thing, we don't know what time of day they showed up. Did they show up early morning, mid-morning, afternoon, early evening? We have no clue. We're not told. Ladies, you know this far better than us guys do. But I looked it up. And the first birth normally takes about 12 to 14 hours of total labor on an average. On an average. Can be less, can be more. That's a long time. We know that Mary gave birth sometime in the night. She may very well have started labor by the time they reached Bethlehem. Again, we don't know. And they get there, and where do they stay? You know, for I don't know how many times I heard it over the first years that I was a Christian, that, oh, the innkeeper was such a horrible person, wouldn't let them stay there. We don't know that. We have no clue. What, you know, if it was even an inn in the sense that we normally think of it, how many other people were going in and out of Bethlehem at the time who would have wanted a place to stay? And if Mary and Joseph didn't get there until a little bit later, there may well have been no place to stay. So, if the innkeeper told them about a stable, or if they managed to find it, or if somebody else told them about it, we don't know. But that's where they went. So turn, if you will, to Luke chapter 2, a very passage that Linus was nice enough to quote for us. That, by the way, is probably one of my favorite Christmas programs. But then I've always been a fan of Peanuts. Some people think I'm nuts anyway. No smart remarks, Bob. In chapter 2 of Luke, it says, "It came to pass in those days that a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This census took place while Quirinius was governing Syria. So all went to be registered, everyone to his own city. Joseph also went up from Galilee out of the city of Nazareth into Judea to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed wife, who was with child." And again, it's important that he was of the house and lineage of David, because the Old Testament had promised through God that the Messiah would be born from the house of David. And David would have a kingdom forever. But obviously, David wasn't going to be around. He died. His son Solomon died, and others in that line died, but God had promised that a Messiah would come. We've been looking at that off and on in Sunday school as a part of the importance of the Old Testament, and we spent several months looking at different verses from the Old Testament itself which refer to the Messiah, or at least I think they do. There are some that are questionable in some respects, but by and large, the Old Testament speaks of the Messiah. So Joseph was of the line of David is really important. So in verse 6 it says, "So it was while they were there, the days were completed for her to be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn." Wow. A manger. Essentially what amounts to a feeding trough, which would have had to have been cleaned out a little bit in all probability. It's not a very nice spot to be in, but what do you do when there's no good place to stay? And this little baby is born. Well, as we get into chapter 2, this is kind of neat. "There were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night." Notice it was at night. "And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were greatly afraid." Wouldn't you be? You're out there, it's quiet. You're a shepherd, you're not expecting anything. And bingo, an angel appears. And it says there's the glory of the Lord shone round about them. Now, I don't know how far away these shepherds were from the city of Bethlehem. That's always been a question. Would anybody else have seen any of this or heard any of this? I don't know the answer to that. Second thing, Bob, that I don't know. I got Bob this morning because I told him there was something I didn't know and it surprised him. A lot of things I don't know, but this is one of them. Was this something that was just given strictly to the shepherds in a way that nobody else could see it? I don't know. All I know is here they are out in the field, and wow, here's an angel. And God's glory is shining around these men. Wouldn't you be afraid? I think I would be, because we certainly wouldn't expect that to happen, and God's glory is incredible. Think about it when Moses said that he wanted to see God. God said, "Not going to happen. Nobody sees me in my essence and lives." So God put Moses in a cleft of a rock and allowed him to see what they're called the hinder parts of God, whatever that means. Nobody sees the essence of God and survives. We can't do it. We're mere human beings. So rightly so, these guys are afraid. And the angel says to them, "Do not be afraid. For behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." We were talking about this in Sunday school. And Paul had mentioned it, that in all probability, the things that were told to Mary and Joseph, the things that were told to these shepherds, they got parts of, but full understanding, probably not even close. I mean, look at the disciples. There are things like in John. It says they didn't understand certain things until after the resurrection. They didn't get the fact that this person in front of them was not just a human being. And here are the shepherds out in the field, and this angel says, there's a baby that's been born, who is the Messiah. But he doesn't just say the Messiah, he says, the Messiah, the Lord. And one of the things that we looked at in the Old Testament, there are several places in the Old Testament where God, in talking about the Messiah, implies, first of all, that this person is more than God. And then there are other places which make it pretty clear that this is Yahweh, God, in the flesh. And think about what Jesus said to the disciples on the road to Emmaus. Didn't you know? Shouldn't you have known all of these things from Scripture? And it says he went back through Moses, the prophets, and all of Scripture and explained to them about himself. It's there. But, like anybody else, sin has its effects. It's blinding. And we don't always see the things that we should see. Aren't you glad that God is merciful? So the disciples, or the shepherds, they say, you know, I always think this is kind of cute, because after the multitude of the angels show up and they're going, glory to God in the highest on earth, peace, goodwill toward men, it says in verse 15, so it was when the angels had gone away from them into heaven that the shepherds said to one another, let us now go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us. You think maybe there was a little, the words are so plain, but you think maybe there was some excitement there? If these people over the years had heard about a coming Messiah, even if they didn't understand all the details, even if some of them thought there'd be a religious Messiah and other ones a political Messiah, there's a Messiah who's been born. You think they'd be excited? I think they were. You know, we've got a nice easy record here, you know, it just says, you know, let's go to Bethlehem and see what's going on. I don't think it was that plain. I think it was more like, man, this is really cool. We got to go see what's going on. And off they go. Now, obviously, I'm putting some things in our vernacular, and I'm not speaking in Aramaic, so, which you're fortunate that I don't try to speak in Aramaic. Bad enough if I anymore if I try to speak German, and it doesn't work too well. But think about these guys. They got to be excited about this. What's going on? So, in verse 16, it says, they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. Now when they had seen him, they made widely known the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all those who heard it marveled at those things which were told them by the shepherds. So these guys come to the manger, they see this little baby who is the Messiah. Again, they don't understand all the implications of this. That's going to come later. But think about this. These guys actually get to see the Messiah as a baby. And they go around telling people. Now it says people marveled, didn't say they all believed, but it says they all marveled. What's going on? Wow, maybe the Messiah's been born? This is really cool. A lot of people probably felt that way. But now think what happens. This little baby starts growing up. And probably at this point, nobody hears about him again. He's born in a manger. He's not born in a king's palace, where people are going to be talking about him all the time. And the excitement probably faded. Many of the shepherds who were older probably weren't around when Jesus started his ministry. But some of the younger men, because I'm sure there were, would have been. And now all of a sudden, Jesus starts his ministry, And can you believe some of these people? You know, I remember seeing this little baby they said was a Messiah. Could this be the Messiah, the one who was that baby? Wonder, don't know for sure, but it makes you wonder. Keep your finger in chapter 2, but go back to Matthew chapter 2 for a moment. A little time goes by, probably anywhere between a few months to a year and a half. Verse 1, it says, "Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, 'Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we have seen a star in the east and have come to worship him.'" Now we don't know about these guys, a great deal about these guys. We sing the song, "We Three Kings." Again, we don't know if they're kings. Some people have said they were just astrologers. We don't know all the details. For some reason, the other thing we don't know is, how did they even know he was born? If they came from the east, we don't even know how. But somehow, somebody, somewhere, had to have spread the word far enough that these guys came to see who this baby was and to worship him. Now, did they worship him as the Messiah? Did they just worship him because he was a king? A lot of details we don't know. But one of the things they did is they brought gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And it has been believed for a good many years that these were the gifts that helped Mary and Joseph when they had to go to Egypt, which would have been expensive to do. But they had to do it. So regardless of whether these wise men were people who truly believed in the Messiah coming or not, God led them here with the gifts that were valuable for Mary and Joseph to be able to use. Again, I don't know all the details with them. And back in Luke chapter 2, verse 21, it says, "When the 8 days were completed for the circumcision of the child, his name was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb." And remember that Joseph was told, or that Mary was told, that his name would be called Jesus. It's interesting, by the way, how did Joseph know that the dream was real about the angel? Said he saw it in a dream, saw the angel in a dream. I would suggest, I mean, how many of us remember all our dreams every time we wake up? Probably not very many of us. I would suggest that when God gives a dream, it's very clear that it's God speaking in some way, whether it's himself or through a messenger, like the angel. He knew. Well, in any event, we were told the name would be Jesus, which is God saves. In verse 22, it says, "When the days of her purification, according to the law of Moses, were completed, they brought him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every male who opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons." The reason it was turtle doves or pigeons is because they didn't have a lot of money. And that was the last of the offerings. Normally it would have been a lamb or something like that. But if you were really poor, pigeons or turtle doves were acceptable. The days of the purification were another 33 days beyond, so it's about 40 days after the birth. So they haven't left yet to go to Egypt, which is why between the time the Magi showed up and Jesus' birth, that's when this is happening. And I think that part of the reason Herod went to 2 years old with the kids is to make sure he got the age group that he wanted. Because he wanted to be sure that Herod wasn't a nice guy. When you have relatives killed because you are concerned about they might take over, you're not a very nice person. So I think when Herod had these 2-year-olds and under killed, It was just to make absolutely certain he was within the age group that he wanted to get rid of the Messiah. It didn't work very well, because God had other plans. But it is interesting, verse 25, it says, "Behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and this man was just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel." Here's a man who expected and was waiting for the Messiah. While many Jews didn't understand about the Messiah and weren't really waiting for him, look at what they did. Jesus showed up. And it was really evident from the things that he said and did that he is the Messiah. And look at what the leadership did. They rejected him and wanted him crucified. Simeon's waiting for the consolation of Israel. It says the Holy Spirit was upon him, and it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. So he came by the Spirit into the temple. And when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, "Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all peoples, a light to bring revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel." I like what he says. "My eyes have seen your salvation." You realize you can't go to your closet and pull a box of salvation off the shelf. Not going to work. Salvation is Jesus Christ. That's why he said, "Believe in me." When the Pharisees and the scribes wanted to know what great work they could do, Jesus said, "This is the work of God, that you believe on the one whom he has sent." Believe. Jesus and Jesus alone is our salvation. Verse 33 says, "Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which were spoken of him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, 'Behold, this child is destined for the fall and rising of many in Israel, and for a sign which will be spoken against.'" In other words, he's going to be rejected. "Yes, a sword will pierce through your own soul also." Mary had to watch Jesus die on a cross, not yet fully understanding what was going on. And then Simeon goes on to say that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed. Then in verse 36, it says, "There was one, Anna, a prophetess, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was of great age and had lived with a husband 7 years from her virginity. And this woman was a widow of about 84 years who did not depart from the temple, but served God with fastings and prayers night and day. And coming in that instant, she gave thanks to the Lord and spoke of him to all who looked for redemption in Jerusalem." Commentators don't know for sure whether Anna was 84 years old or whether she'd been a widow for 84 years. It doesn't matter. In any event, at the very least, she was 84 years old. If she'd been a widow for 84 years and had been married at 13, she would have been widowed at 20 and would be about 104. In either case, this is not a young lady. And she has been in the temple this whole time. She lives there. She works there. Night and day, she cares about the things of God. She ought to say something about us. But here's another person who recognizes the Messiah when she sees him and spreads the word. Absolutely marvelous. One of the most momentous of historical events in human history occurred on this night when Jesus was born. But that birth means absolutely nothing if it isn't for his life, his death, his burial, and resurrection. If it's not for that, it's just another birth. But this is truly a holy night. When Jesus was born, God in human flesh came down as a baby, help us a little child. Had to be fed, had to be cleaned up, had to grow like any other human being and learn things like other human beings. And yet at the age of 12, he knew exactly where he should be in God's plan, because he is the Messiah. He is God in human flesh. And he came for one reason, to die on a cross for you and me. We were talking briefly this morning that, like in Genesis and Revelation, you read about the tree of life. And I don't know all of the details as to why that's referred to. There are all sorts of commentators and theories about why God put a tree of life in the Garden of Eden and why it's referred to in Revelation. But think about this. On a cross, Jesus hung on, as it said, a tree, a cross, to provide life for you and me. There is a tree of life. I think the other tree is rather symbolic, but I don't know. I just know that there is a real tree of life that happened just about 2,000 years ago now. That's incredible. He isn't back yet, but he's coming, and coming soon. But it is his substitutionary death on the cross that's really important. So, if you would, turn to Luke chapter 22 for a moment. Jesus has had his disciples prepare for the Passover. And in verse 14 of chapter 22, it says, "When the hour had come, he sat down and the 12 apostles with him. Then he said to them with fervent desire, 'I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I will no longer eat of it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God.' Then he took the cup and gave thanks and said, 'Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes.' And he took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it to them, saying, 'This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' Likewise, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you. But behold, the hand of my betrayer is with me on the table. And truly the Son of Man goes as it has been determined. But woe to that man by whom he is betrayed.'" Paul and Carl, if you would come up, we will have our communion.
Heavenly Father, as we celebrate the Lord's Supper here, we realize that this babe who was born on that first Christmas, so to say, was not only a baby boy, but was God himself. So we know that Jesus lived a sinful life. I mean, did not live a sinful life, and so he didn't deserve death like we do. But yet he voluntarily gave his body to be beaten and bruised and nailed to the cross and to the point.
First Corinthians 11, Paul wrote, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me.'" Let's Carl, do you give thanks for us, Lord?
Father, again, we come to you. We thank you for this day. We thank you for this Christmas Eve day that we have to remember you coming with your Son. We thank you for him coming and to die for us for our sins. We pray, Lord, also now that you could partake of this drink that you would bless it to us. Help us to remember this.
In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let's pray that Paul will lead us in song. Father, we just thank you that we can celebrate not only the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ, but the reason he came, his death, his burial, his resurrection. Thank you for that. Thank you that so he's coming again. We have to have him. Lord, we just pray. Give me a word that we say. I'll just thank you in Jesus' name.
Okay, let's finish up our service with one last song, number 181, "Hark the Herald Angels Sing."
Mercy, mild, God, and sin.
thank you very much. We are dismissed, and Happy New Year. And Merry Christmas.